Hello, everyone. Today we'll be continuing the Young Lords' A Radical History. Last chapter we read how the Young Lords occupied a hospital and provided for the people and their medical needs. And we'll be continue and we'll read the aftermath of what happened after they occupied a hospital. But as always, we always start with the statement of unity, which I will bring up right now just to share my screen. There we go. All right, can y'all see this?
Yeah.
Right on. All right. I'll begin reading the Statement of Unity preface. The US was founded as a colonial settler state based upon white supremacy and slavery, stealing the lands of the indigenous nations, breaking every treaty made with them, and confining them to quote unquote reservations, concentration camps. As the country became more powerful, the eagle sunk its claws to other nations, making war on Mexico and grabbing its northern territory, invading Cuba, Puerto Rico, Hawaii, and the Philippines, and either annexing them outright or making them colonies or neocolonies. And in the 20th century, it became the major imperialist power of the world, exploiting both the people within its boundaries and those in every other country, bullying them with military interventions, and robbing them of their right of self-determination. As Hugh P. Newton stated, quote, "We have two enemies to fight, racism and capitalism. Between the two, capitalism is primary. Racism is a byproduct of capitalism. The working people of the world, of every ethnicity or nationality, face a common enemy that is destroying life on Earth. Our enemy is a small ruling class of property owners controlling most of the world's wealth and resources. We must have our basic needs to met to live a good and meaningful life. Food, shelter, health care, education, freedom from the oppression by the state, and peace with other nations. To obtain these essential things for life, we must have the power to see to it that the abundance that is available is shared equitably." Statement of Unity for the Second Rainbow Coalition. The legacy of the First Rainbow Coalition dates back to its founding on April 4th, 1969, by the original Black Panther Party, original Young Lords, and Young Patriots organization. A number of other organizations joined this coalition not too long afterwards, such as the American Indian Movement, Brown Berets, Rising Up Angry, the Red Guards, and others. Since the founding of the United States, the masses have developed a number of popular movements that came together to fight back against this capitalist imperialist system in various ways around particular demands. Nevertheless, none has established a movement quite like the First Rainbow Coalition. This historic example was the first of its kind that established a model of class struggle like no other. Its charismatic leader, Chairman Fred Hampton of the Illinois chapter of the original Black Panther Party, stated that at the end of the day, we weren't engaged in a race struggle. He said that it's a class struggle, goddammit. By uniting with the various oppressed ethnicities and masses, they were able to bridge the gap between the various ethnic communities that white supremacy had long sought to keep divided. This class solidarity equipped them with the material basis and class consciousness to see their common class condition. Therefore, the necessity to form a united front against this cap against their common class oppressor, the capitalist imperialist ruling class. The ruling class viewed this as the greatest threat to their class rule, and subsequently used the entire oppressive forces of the state, police, courts, jails, prisons, intelligence agencies, etc., in order to crush this emerging revolutionary socialist movement. We refounded the Rainbow Coalition on May 14th, 2021, with the intent of upholding the legacy of the original Rainbow Coalition. We believe that this historic example is the model for the United Front that will best serve our class liberation. By upholding the template program of the original Black Panther Party, which was subsequently adopted and later expanded by the original Young Lords, Young Patriots organization, and all other original Rainbow Coalition members, we establish our pragmatic unity. The six disciplinary rules that we uphold ties all organizations in our coalition to a common professional discipline. History is bestowed upon our generation a common class mission to fulfill. The representatives of the capitalist imperialist ruling class, represented by the Democratic Party and the Republican Party, cannot liberate us. It is their class intention and class interest to uphold our common class oppression. Therefore, it is only we, the oppressed masses of all ethnicities and nationalities, who must build the necessary class solidarity, class consciousness, organizational structures, and a united front that will ultimately liberate ourselves. This is what the Second Rainbow Coalition is committed to. This is the historic mission we intend to fulfill. Dare to struggle, dare to win. All members of the coalition, New African Black Panther Party, White Panther Party, Green Party of New Jersey, Poor People's Army, La Mesa Nacional de Brown Berets, NASL, North Alabama School for Organizers, New Era Young Lords, and American Indian Movement's Northeast Woodland Chapter. The six disciplinary rules. Number one, members will conduct themselves in a manner to bring credit to the coalition and will treat others with respect and politeness. Number two, members will be sober when on Rainbow Coalition business, and will not engage in any criminal activity while a member. Number three, no member will engage in violence except in the extremity of self-defense. Number four, members will not gossip nor be divisive to the unity of the Second Rainbow Coalition. Number five, members will not act as informers to work against the purpose of the Second Rainbow Coalition. And number six, nobody is authorized to speak for the Second Rainbow Coalition unless authorized to do so. And that is the statement of unity. And with that, we will begin reading the book. Let me just pull it up right here. Just pull it up. Ba-da-ba. I just gotta see what pages we will be reading and not reading. Here we go. Okay. September 17th. Pages 293 to 305. Okay, this one is going to be a bit short then. 293 to 305. 293 to 305. Shanti, could you please stream the book? I'll send you the link for it.
Already have it in my so
Right on.
yeah.
So we'll begin on. We'll begin on page. Fuck, I forgot already. We'll begin on page. On page 293.
Do y'all see it?
I see it. Yep.
Okay.
That's a picture that we saw last time. Awesome. And there we go, the aftermath.
Right. Want me to go?
Sure, yeah.
Okay. The aftermath. From July until December of 1970, the crisis at Lincoln became central to the city's political debates. James Buckley, the Conservative Party candidate for U.S. Senator, called the occupation a, quote, vigilante action and denounced Mayor Lindsay's decision to send his own chief assistant, Sid Davidoff, quote, to negotiate with the extremists. And while Lecote, the hospital's chief administrator, and Einhorn, the head of pediatrics, acknowledged the validity of the activist grievances, they took issue with the YLP's and TLC's quote unquote extremism and questioned the authenticity of their ties to the community. Very funny. In response, Cleo Silvers explained, those people that recognize problems and are willing to move on them in the interest of all the people and not a small segment of the community are those people who represent the community. Our position is that we do not say that we represent the South Bronx. We are an element of the community, which has been able to articulate the problems. Our job is to get out to the people in the community with this information, to organize the people in the community, and to involve them in making changes along with us, because we won't be able to make any changes without large numbers of people in the community. We feel that the only way that a person can be a bona fide representative of the community is by his practice, by what he has done to prove that he is representing the people of the community and not himself. In her statement, Silvers defined the role of the Vanguard Party as defender and advocate of the broadest and most progressive interests of poor and working people. To Silvers and the Young Lords, Vanguard leadership had to combine analyzing the world's problems with charting political direction alongside the broadest possible number of oppressed people. Striking this balance will require an accurate assessment of both the political state of affairs and the level of consciousness of their community base at any given moment. Just days after the July 14th occupation, a new crisis erupted. On July 17th, Carmen Rodriguez went into Lincoln's gynecology service for an abortion. The Puerto Rican woman was a longstanding patient at Lincoln. She had been addicted to heroin and was an active member of Logos, a community-initiated heroin treatment center in the South Bronx at which progressive Lincoln doctors volunteered. According to one of the doctors who supervised Logos, resident psychiatrist and TLC member Mike Smith, Rodriguez was well-known and had endeared herself to Logos' drug rehabilitation workers because of her caring spirit. She was fortified by Khalil Gibran's writings, carried his books with her daily, and regularly implored the people around her to treat each other with kindness. Though New York State had legalized abortion just 2 weeks earlier, Rodriguez had been approved for the procedure under the old abortion law because she had rheumatic heart disease and delivering a baby would endanger her life. Smith explains that her procedure occurred just 2 weeks after a new cohort of residents and interns relieved the old class of doctors in training because, quote, the attendings were different. The doctors were different. They knew nothing of her medical background at all. And in those days at public hospitals, you didn't always get records. So they assumed that she was there simply to get an abortion. Abortions were relatively simple procedures, but they had not been performed with any regularity before. And at Lincoln, there was no established protocol and no formal training of doctors. The resident on call that day performed a saline-based abortion procedure, whose severely harmful effects on patients with heart disease were well known. Rodriguez became short of breath, but without a chart, the resident proceeded to treat her for what he assumed to be asthma and then repeated the same course again. According to Smith, the resident assumed that Rodriguez was a Puerto Rican woman with asthma, a common category, but not a universal category. And so he gives her medicine for asthma, and that's medicine that makes the heart patient much worse. She was quite correctable. And again, she was a person who knew the difference between asthma and heart disease. Although Rodriguez was likely conscious and quote unquote could enunciate beautifully, whatever the fuck that means, she was being treated in a medical environment in which the patient was often infantilized. She was never consulted about what was happening to her body and how the medical care she was receiving might have been harming her. She died on July 19th, 3 days after the abortion. On the day of her death, the TLC activists demanded a meeting with a coach. According to the activists, they were told that Rodriguez's was a complicated case beyond their comprehension. The activists retorted, quote, We knew what they were talking about and also what they wanted to hide. They drafted a set of demands calling for damages to be paid to our family, for the head of the abortion clinic, Dr. J.J. Smith, to be removed unless a community worker committee was set up to oversee the program, and for the abortion clinic to be named after Carmen Rodriguez. Within days, Rodriguez's record was leaked to the TLC by Mike Smith, who was well aware that her death was due to negligence. The tragedy of Rodriguez's death called into question the methods of care institutionalized in the public hospitals as a result of medical school affiliation contracts. In the affiliation system, patients were never assigned their own primary care physicians. A patient would likely see a different doctor, whoever was on call, from visit to visit. The resulting reliance on inexperienced students' treatment decisions increased the probability of disastrous outcomes. Moreover, the fact that no one doctor followed the progress of any patient over time meant that cases such as Rodriguez's could fall through the cracks. Although the affiliation contract was conceived with mutual benefits in mind for both the city's poor and the medical schools, in actuality, the medical training of interns and residents and the schools' research needs became major forces in shaping hospital practices. One of the key reforms that came out of the activism at Lincoln was the emergence of continuity clinics in public hospitals, where patients are seen by the primary care doctor. This program was conceived by the doctors in the Lincoln Collective. Another remarkable result negotiated by the Young Lords was that the hospital administration consented to a clinical pathological conference. In late July, the hospital hosted a public hearing, where administrators presented Rodriguez's diagnosis, treatment, and the medical complications that led to her death. The audience then asked questions, and doctors from other institutions presented counterarguments about the care she should have received. This type of public clinical conference, allowing a lay audience to cross-examine a team of medical doctors, has been cited as the first of its kind in the history of medicine. Though the meeting proved grossly contentious with a lot of hissing and heckling, according to one of the doctors in the collective, quote, "The fact of the meeting was an important event. It was a troubled, even tortured example of community control of medical services. At the least, it was a real insignificant instance of physicians being called out to account by community people. The agenda did not flow easily, but the very meeting of the two sides to discuss a medical event stood as a victory for community participation in the hospital." After the clinical conference, the crisis surrounding Rodriguez's case escalated. The TLC charged the department with genocide, which is essentially what it is. In its estimation, the clinical conference was a victory, but Rodriguez's murder, which was due to systemic negligence, required accountability, continued campaigning for fundamental change, and reprisals at the administrative level. On August 25th, 1970, TLC activists met with the head of the Division of Obstetrics and Gynecology, J.J. Smith, repeating their demands once again and adding that Smith should reinstate the only Black doctor in gynecology, who the activists alleged was fired because he stood up to Smith. A more than two-hour meeting was filled with acrimony, after which the activists took a measure into their own hands and fired him. They escorted the doctor to his car, pushed him around, and told him to never come back. Never to come back. According to Cleo Silvers, the conflict reached a fever pitch because of the arrogant and racist disposition of the doctors, even the progressive ones among them, which is very, very important to note right here. She remembers, quote, "If Dr. J.J. Smith had conceded to even some of our demands, and if the administration hadn't tried to cover up what we knew was all too common at Lincoln, the daily disregard for the lives of people of color, we wouldn't have had to take the actions we took." Surprisingly, the activists were able to get away with such acts because they had relatively free rein in the hospital. Its chief administrator, Antero Lacote, had not asked them to disband the complaint table they had set up in the ER in late spring 1970 or the daycare center they established during the July 14th occupation. J.J. Smith resigned shortly after the altercation with the activists in his office. In response, 27 residents and interns of his apartment, most of whom were foreign doctors, went on a 10-day strike in his support from August 25th through September 3rd. The interns continued to work at another affiliate of the Albert Einstein College of Medicine, Jacoby Hospital, but their actions shut down Lincoln's obstetrics and gynecology department. The interns and residents voted to return only if the activists were barred from interfering with any aspect of work in their department. Really? To this end, on August 27th, 1970, the hospital sought a restraining order against the Young Lords, the TLC, HRUM, and all other activists. And Tara Lacote reported to the New York Times that the injunction was served to the Young Lords because they had, quote, exceeded the ground rules. Very funny. But Lacote was equivocal in his condemnation of the radicals. He had previously acknowledged that although their actions were extreme, they had helped move the Lincoln bureaucracy towards change, perhaps because he sensed the value of their controversial presence, and perhaps because he was unaware of the draconian character of the injunction. He reported to the New York Times that the activists would be allowed to continue to run their daycare and complaint table. But the top city officials, the courts, and the mainstream media were collaborating with institutions in all spheres of public life, from schools to the hospitals, to institutionalize heavy security measures against activists like the Young Lords and their supporters. So you can put two and two together here. The injunction was served on the same day that the New York Times editorial board penned a scathing editorial against the Young Lords titled "Crisis at Lincoln." Because this editorial and another news article both referenced the terms and effective date of the restraining order, it is likely that efforts were coordinated between the newspaper, the city attorneys, and the hospital administration, tools of the bourgeoisie to keep in mind. The editorial portrayed the striking Lincoln physicians as heroes and the Young Lords as villains, explaining that because of quote-unquote doctor shortage, when many alternative jobs were available, it requires physicians with special dedication to the disadvantaged to be willing to put up with Lincoln's many difficulties. But the profile of physicians at Lincoln, the majority of whom were foreign doctors seeking to gain licenses in the United States, were far more complicated, and there was no mention of the pediatric collective, which together with the Young Lords launched a door-to-door preventative medicine program in the South Bronx. The editorial derided the Young Lords as, quote, a Puerto Rican imitation of the Black Panthers, created, quote, a climate of fear and conflict in the hospital and took to, quote, harassing doctors and nurses, a far cry from what actually happened. Okay. Using the symbolic remnants and language of McCarthyism, okay?
Yep, anti-communist bullshit.
It charged a group with, quote, unquote, invading the hospital and implicitly impunged its administrators for allowing the wards to, quote, to become a fixture in it. Like this is literally McCarthyism all over again. They got the support of the community. They caught the public's eye. But the tools of the bourgeoisie once again went against them and called them a Puerto Rican imitation of the Black Panthers, even though the Young Lords were very close with the Black Panthers, the Rainbow Coalition. So, I mean, they knew that, but they wanted to make the public, once again, tricking the masses again with McCarthyist language because it's more believable that way, to yep. make it seem like the Young Lords were this Boricua vigilante group, like the Weather Underground. They're not the Weather Underground. Like, the takeover was nothing like the Weather Underground.
If the Weather Underground did that shit, they would have gone with guns blasting. The Young Lords didn't do that. They didn't even bring any guns. They only brought batons with them. They didn't even bring a single gun in there. And that McCarthy's bullshit that they're saying, look at the words that they're choosing. It charged the group with invading the hospital, similarly to how McCarthy himself said how the USSR would quote unquote invade the United States, a communist takeover.
Happened,
The same shit.
which never happened.
Exactly.
It never happened, but they want to once again trick the public with all this bullshit with McCarthyism. With McCarthyism. Do you see this word? This is a key
Yep.
word right here. This is a key word right here.
McCarthyism.
I don't want to keep this in mind. This is what they do to suppress the community support of these groups. This is what they rely on. This is their fight response. This is their fight response. If they feel like they're under threat, or if they need, because they have nothing to lose, they will result to McCarthyism. McCarthyism. This is what they do, people. So
Propaganda, lying, deceit, et
propaganda,
cetera, et cetera.
propaganda, infiltration, anything, anything to suppress that revolutionary potential, because once again, the empire has nothing to lose. So it's very important that, especially for today, that we pay attention to what the bourgeois media is doing, because they are going far and beyond to suppress our potential, because we are now starting to slowly see that everyone is a target under this system. It doesn't matter how privileged you are, we are all a target, and this is exactly what they're doing right here with McCarthyism.
Where no one is safe. And that right there, people need to understand that people need to understand that that when it comes to the state and that when it comes to these institutions, it's not just the military, it's not just the police, the media, the editors, the journalists, they all work for the state. US media is US propaganda. They are one and the same. They will deceit, lie, whitewash, defang, and mix and misconstrued actual events in order to demonize liberation groups, to belittle and dehumanize movements and militancy, and to embolden and bolster bourgeois thought, to encourage individualistic behavior, to keep the masses fighting amongst themselves, to by lying to them. Like, your knowledge is power. It all starts with ourselves. Before we can even do anything, it all starts with what we know and what information we have and what education we have. That's where it all starts first.
And to build on it. So,
And to build on it. McCarthyism.
keyword here, okay.
Yep.
In a letter responding to the New York Times editorial, Eli C. Messinger, national chairman of the Medical Committee for Human Rights, pointed out the contradiction between its quote, righteous condemnation of conditions at Lincoln and its quote, even stronger condemnation of the methods of those trying to affect change. Messinger itemized the quote unquote constructive activities of the radicals and emphasized the failure of quote the medical profession and the city to redress quote the abominable conditions of the hospital until the young lords and others quote unquote began to directly institute changes. He also explored the merits of the Young Lords' most controversial demand, the Community Worker Board, to set policy for the hospital, arguing that hospital workers and community residents were best positioned to, quote unquote, identify major health problems and, quote, shape corrective programs relevant to their communities. He went on to say that community control was less about, quote, lay interference in the technical aspects of medical care, and more about compelling, quote, physicians and administrators to abdicate their elitist roles of prescribing the structure of health services. The conservative politician James Buckley, eager for any publicity that might help his mayoral campaign, also weighed in. Like others, including the New York Times editorial board, he misapprehended the facts, failed to address the grievances that led to protests, and used the language of crime. Crime. to describe the actions of the radicals at Lincoln. Buckley observed, quote, not only was the superintendent of the hospital held hostage by extremists, but women and labor were actually turned away from the hospital doors because the rest of the medical staff could not function in this sort of chaotic environment. Pay attention to the language that they use. Pay attention here. What Buckley characterized as a hostage situation involving the superintendent of the hospital was in fact the activist firing of the head of gynecology, J.J. Smith. Buckley also blamed the young lord's July 14th occupation for the disruption of services in the gynecology department. Speaking to the New York Post, young lord Pablo Guzman retorted, quote, the only disruption of services came about when those doctors who supported Smith left of their own volition, not because of any threat, which is a fact. Even though the hospital's chief administrator told the New York Times that the court injunction would allow the activists to continue to run the daycare and the complaint table, the injunction failed to bring the doctors back to work. Their work stoppage and temporary transfer to Jacoby Hospital may have offered some comparative perspective. Now, in addition to their harassment complaint against the young lords, they were demanding that the workloads be reduced at Lincoln. But when the city threatened to terminate its $28 million affiliation contract with the Einstein Medical College, Einstein forced the doctors to return to their posts. Other departments, including pediatrics and psychiatry, were also swept up in the conflict. Arnold Einhorn, the chief of the pediatrics department and its pioneer, was replaced by the acclaimed Dr. Helen Rodriguez Trias after protests by pediatric doctors within the Lincoln Collective. In their view, Einhorn was too rigid to allow the kind of training program the dissident doctors sought to establish, in which department policy was determined through collective discussion in weekly meetings that included the nurses. The doctors in training wanted to challenge the individualism, elitism, and sexism of the medical profession and consciousness-raising circles, not unlike those that emerged in the women's movement. They also initiated a pediatric parents association to involve parents in the life of the department. Other innovations, like drawing straws to decide who was in charge of the daily rounds, were deeply flawed and didn't last. Ironically, Einhorn's ouster by a group of mostly young Jewish doctors in training was decried by the American Jewish Congress and the Jewish Defense League as an instance of anti-Semitism. A civil rights investigation by the city ultimately led to Einhorn's reinstatement. Do I keep reading or?
I could read it. I could read it if you want me to.
I mean, you can.
Right on. I'll read this segment, and if I remember correctly, because let me just check, we stop at page. Yes, we stop at page 305.
305. Okay.
Yep. So thankfully, it's not that long. okay, let me just do this. There we go. Patient Bill of Rights. Before Carmen Rodriguez's death, the TLC had experimented with a variety of tactics in its fight for improved conditions and greater influence over the governance of the hospital. The activists held rallies, drafted a series of petitions and demands, convened the meetings with hospital administration, and occupied buildings. All the while, their presence in the hospital was anchored by their 24-hour patient/worker complaint table in the emergency room. As we have seen, the activist demands reflected grievances surrounding local conditions and an attempt to introduce the notion of preventative care through medical home visits at the neighborhood level. Another set of demands drafted in late summer 1970 by HRUM and the Young Lords proved uniquely influential in the field of medicine. Drafted in the cauldron of protests following Rodriguez's death, the demands aim to establish a protocol of communication between patients and doctors, minimizing the incidence of such tragedies and, in the future and investing patients with knowledge and control over their care, of recasting patients in the eyes of the medical profession as citizens with the constitutional rights. The patient bill of rights demanded these rights.
Yeah.
Number one, to be treated with dignity and respect. Two, to have all treatment explained and to refuse any treatment you feel is not in your best interest. Three, to know what medicine is being prescribed and what it's for and what side effects it will cause. Four, to have access to your medical chart. Five, to have door-to-door preventive medicine programs. Six, to choose a doctor you want to have and to have the same doctor treat you all the time. Seven, to call your doctor to your home. Eight, to receive free meals while waiting for outpatient service. Nine, to have free daycare centers in all hospital facilities. And 10, to receive free healthcare. Oh, you know they're not going to do that one. You already know they were never going to do that one.
Oh, no, 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 no. They're not going to do that because it's all is, you know, it's all about profit. So, you know, they have
yep.
to, you know, they have to kind of, you know,
it's not
hold some strings, but, you know, not cater to the people like that because, you know,
exactly.
You know, being it free and fundamentally a right of ours for all of us makes us, you know, lazy, you know,
yep.
Like
exactly. It's not health care. It's health business. That's what it is.
Business. Business. The keyword is business. People. Is business.
Yep. Right on. With its far-reaching implications for the relationship between patients and doctors, rearticulations of HRUM's Patient Bill of Rights have been adopted by hospitals across the nation under the same name. Part of what was remarkable about this list how do you pronounce that? Prescience. I have no idea what that word means. It significantly advanced the standards and ethics of patient care and patient rights in public discourse and helped enshrine concepts such as patient dignity, full disclosure and explanation of medical treatments and prescriptions and their side effects, and the right of the patient to refuse treatment. At the same time, it anticipated in its call for free healthcare what remains one of the most contentious debates about public health. And before we continue, I just want to say here, all of these, right, all of these social welfare policies that we have, all of these policies and all these things that we have today, they were done by these radical organizations that actually cared about the people. If it wasn't for the Black Panthers, we wouldn't have flaggers to stop cars on the street to let kids pass. And if it wasn't for the Young Lords, and if it wasn't for the Young Lords and the TLC, we wouldn't have these progressive medical policies that actually gave more dignity to patients. They never hear about these things. You never hear why these things were implemented. They're whitewashed, taken out of history, and they make us think that the government did all these things, that they were here from the very beginning, that the government has always cared about us. Nope. It was only when exactly. It's a lie. It was only when people started complaining that they actually did something about it. And that has been basically the relationship between the working class and the bourgeois. It's only when there is a perceived threat that the bourgeois begin actually doing listening to our demands.
Exactly. And like the fact of the matter is, you know, if it wasn't for that takeover, youth taking over the hospital, being there for the community, making the public listen to them for once, but what was going on, they would not have these Bill of Rights. They would not have, you know, this fundamental, basic affirmation of our livelihood. And so, it, you know, we give credit to a lot of them. But once again, they don't want us to know that. They don't want us to know. Because it's all about the government, the government, the government. But the government made these conditions to where they took over.
Exactly. They created these conditions. They were the ones that caused these things. It was a government that made these conditions worse that eventually led to the young lords taking over that hospital, that eventually led to the young lords doing their church offensive, that eventually led to the young lords doing their lead offensive. It was the government's nonchalant attitude about the actual care of society and of the masses that led to these organizations coming about. And that's basically what society is. In a bourgeois capitalist imperial society, it is all about what benefits the bourgeois, making life more expensive, more harder, while taking away your wages, lowering your hours, all to maximize profit. And it is only when we actually start fighting back that that the bourgeois actually start hearing to our demands. But we must never forget. We must never forget that concessions are not enough. We can't just rely on concessions to save us.
They're not enough. They're not enough. Because our ancestors have already had these institutions before we were colonized and before we were enslaved and before it became a commodity that we have to pay for affirmation to our resources, to our medical care. We have to pay, sign signatures for our right to medical care. That's not how we operated at all, because that system was introduced to us by force through genocide. And it's very important that, you know, we cannot just rely on concessions alone. Okay, we got the daycare centers. Okay, we got, you know, the more
blackers,
you know, the more basic changes. But that was 50 years ago.
Exactly.
Now, that's why we have to stand on this now, especially because there are still very much problems. There's still very much problems. I mean, it didn't change. I mean, just because, you know, we had these basic fundamental core affirmations of our livelihood, it didn't change the oppression that was happening to us. As a matter of fact, there are disproportionate numbers of African people with the ability to conceive a child that die under medical care because of racist beliefs, because of class beliefs, that, you know, the so-called Black woman is strong, you know, that they don't feel pain. And that's what leads to the mortality in African people with the ability to conceive, because those beliefs still stayed. Those beliefs are still there. That system is still there. And that is a bigger beast that we have to organize against and reclaim what we have and make it new for us in the now, for the future.
Exactly.
You can literally put 400 African doctors in this hospital and there will still be problems.
Exactly. It won't change anything.
That's why I don't celebrate representation at all, because it's just a way, it tells our ancestors to make nice. I don't believe in making nice. I don't practice it. I don't want to. Making nice is not going to stop the mortality rate with mothers, with African mothers, from dying in the hands of the medical care complex, the health business complex. Because it doesn't matter how many Black faces you put there, it doesn't change a thing. So it's our responsibility as a community to understand that that was just 50 years ago. Now we have to actually make it to where we can actually have medical care for everybody without signatures, without having to pay numbers and decimals and pieces of paper and metal to get care. And even if we do get care in the, in more subpar conditions, no, it has to be adequate and safe and free for everyone. That's the point, right? Our lives are not a commodity. Our lives are not for profit. We're not for profit. We're not cattle. Under the system, we are, but in actuality, we're not cattle.
We're human beings.
We're not cattle that you can just cash off on. We're not cattle. Look at Henrietta Lacks. Look at the story of Henrietta Lacks using their using her cells when she died, to make these medical discoveries, if you can even call them that, and
I
her
remember
family,
that.
yeah, her family having to fight with these institutions to get their compensation for what they were doing. We're not cattle, even when we die. Period.
Beautifully said. And it doesn't matter how many concessions they give us, it doesn't matter how many changes they do, because at the end of the day, the only reason why they even do those concessions in the first place is to try and appease us and to try and de-radicalize us. That's what they want.
For
They
us to
want they, exactly. They want us to make nice, exactly as you were saying. They can pass all the progressive policies they want. But change will not come from above. It's going to come from below. It's going to come from us.
from the root.
That's where it's going to come from.
It doesn't matter how many black faces there are. It doesn't matter how many brown faces there are. It doesn't matter how many yellow faces you put, how many red faces. It doesn't change our oppression in these institutions that make us out to be cattle. And that is what we have to recognize for once, because we're still dying under the brunt of the system that has no infrastructure on purpose, because they never wanted to make an adequate infrastructure to deal with, especially in the beginning of COVID, disproportionate numbers of African and Native people dying because of the prior decades of medical crises and oppression, on top of environmental racism. And then you have this COVID aspect of it. And now you have people literally vomiting in the school, in public, on the sidewalk, literally their bodies literally degrading. Because once again, these changes never did anything. And those doctors never cared for those people the entire time. They just wanted to have a bourgeois entity say, oh, well, it's over, even though it's getting worse. It's over. They just wanted that because they know that it doesn't matter how many oppressed faces you put, it does not change our oppression. And the only way for our oppression to change is meeting the people where they're at, to start reclaiming our resources piece by piece, to take over these institutions and kick the bourgeois system down to the ground and actually take care of each other. It's not just one person, it's an entire group of people, facets of people that deserve basic care without having to be cattle.
All of humanity deserves that.
We're not cattle, once again.
Yep, we're human beings. We, under the capitalist system, sorry, I'm eating peanuts right now. Under the capitalist system, the whole point for our revolution, the whole point for our struggling is to create a new society where we are treated as what we are, human beings, not cattle, not cogs in the machine, not pieces, not pieces that could be replaced and tinkered with and thrown out like nothing. No, human beings with human rights that are inherent from the moment we are born.
Right.
Sorry, yeah. I'm still eating, sorry.
It's okay. It's okay.
All right. Coalition politics, middle class guilt, and revolutionary bravado. Oh, I'm gonna love this chapter. Ooh, it is gonna be a good one. Because we were talking about this before, Shanti, I think. The coalition of individuals and groups that came together to fight for better health care in the South Bronx was riddled with internal tensions. The relationships they built were full of promise, but also strained by conflicts of race, class, and gender. The weakest link in the coalition resolved around the relationship between the TLC itself, an amalgamation of radical organizations and individuals of color, and predominantly white Lincoln Collective. For its part, the Lincoln Collective of Doctors was independently organized and often deluged with responsibilities of medical residency. The Lincoln Collective worked best within the coalition when it could offer concrete skill-based support to the work, as in its contributions to the door-to-door preventive medicine program. The young lords did not tell any of the staff at Lincoln about their takeover in advance. Osborne, among other Lincoln Collective doctors, was unsettled by the surprise occupation. He described the young lords as, quote, he described the young lords as, quote unquote, top down. They might come and say, we're doing this today or we're going to do this tomorrow, unquote. He was resentful that they didn't involve the Lincoln Collective in discussions about strategy. Osborne also perceived the male leadership of the young lords to be, quote unquote, intimidating, arrogant, and secretive, bruh. The young lords and their leadership were unapologetic in deploying both eloquent rhetoric and brawn in their day-to-day work. They inspired thousands of young people across the city with their dramatic antics and their perceptive insights, but they also threatened to beat up corner drug dealers for debasing their neighborhoods and the head of the Lincoln Gynecology Department for his attempts to cover up medical negligence. To a young, white, middle-class doctor unfamiliar with the parlance of the street, who was working in a disfigured urban landscape brimming with petty criminals and drug users, the masculine posturing and street savvy of male members of the Young Lords was likely discomforting. Discomforting. The strident confidence and centralized power of the group's central committee, surely unsettled white middle class notions of legitimate leadership, and
The
the
brush.
brashness of some members of the Young Lords must have unnerved those who had on to any iota of middle class property and respectability. The young lords challenged mainstream perceptions of race, which in turn destabilized the paradigm of power, worldview, and identity of the middle class of all roles, even the radicalized among them. in this in his recollection of activism at Lincoln, Osborne returned to the male bravado and an unilliterate decision. Sorry,
Unilateral.
unilateral decision making of the young lord's leadership as a source of tension. In fact, the young lord had enjoyed quite a number of victories since they had started organizing a year earlier, and the generally positive media attention they enjoyed must have enlarged their egos and made the group, and especially its leadership, feel invincible. But the organization's formal leadership had a mix of personalities, and its most visible leaders were Felipe Luciano, Juan Gonzalez, Pablo Guzman, and Denise Oliver, Juan V. Ortiz, and David Perez were self-effacing. Self-effacing background strategists. Gonzalez was an articulate but low-key strategist and leader of the student strike and occupation at Columbia in 1968. Guzman was a media maven who would pack a punch in a slogan. Luciano, the most charismatic among them, facilitated between poetic ruminations and a street tough persona. And Oliver, a middle class Black American woman, was known. Sorry, and Oliver, a middle class New African woman, was known for the. Don't know how
Haughtiness.
to. Haughtiness
Yeah.
with which she brought down her opponents in an argument. I don't know what that word means. Despite Osborne's critique of the organization's leadership, he sang the praises of the organization's rank and file that was effective at Lincoln. A disproportionately female re representation of the organization, who were also members of HRUM, whom he believed to be, quote, much more earnest and hardworking and humble and sincere, bruh, unquote. While Osborne characterizes the activists at Lincoln as people who often adopted hard lines unnecessarily, overall he said they, quote, were really trying their best to do the right thing. They were very consistent, I think, self-effacing, very altruistic. He's saying it as if they tried but they failed. Like, that's the vibe I'm fucking getting from this guy.
It's funny. It's just funny.
It's really fucking funny, bro. Like, I find it funny how I find it funny how he's just completely shitting on the male members, but he's saying that the female members are like more honest. Like, that was weird.
Like, I mean, like the female members, like the female members of the Young Lords, right? Or the Lincoln
Yeah.
Collective.
I think the female members of the Young Lords, I think.
Well,
Because he was mentioning the Young Lords in this, I believe.
oh, well, I mean, ironic, very ironic, I would say, but I mean, we did talk about,
Yeah. Revolutionary machismo, quote unquote.
the so-called revolutionary machismo in the Young Boys, in the beginning.
Yeah.
Because these are new topics that no one even thought about before. So it was still very, very fresh. So, they thought that it would work, but they saw it was a really, really ridiculous idea. And
Exactly.
they changed it. And once again, these topics were, this type of discussion was still fresh. So,
Indeed.
it was still kind of like that ideological shock, really. They were going
100%.
through like kind of ideology shock, because what they thought was part of life and part of the struggle. And but this was like 53 55 years ago. So, like, it was it and even in a Boricua context, that was definitely, new to everyone. So, yeah, I get it.
100%. Where was sorry,
Also,
what?
do you want me to read at some point?
Oh yeah. Of course. I mean, if you want to read now, you can. You can read where I left off, Comrade Will.
Okay, where'd you leave off again?
Osborne's
Yes.
perception.
No, okay. I see it. Were you gonna say something?
No, I was just telling you where you start.
Okay. Osborne perceptions of the young lords differed from that of Dr. Stephen Levy, a Jewish kid from a working class neighborhood in Philadelphia who conducted home visits with the young lords and was the organization's resident doctor. The young lords played a major quote. There's a lot of quotes. Played a major role in my reassessing where I had come from, what was important, what I should do with my life, .. using one's life for a better purpose than getting rich. Made really resonating sense for me. End quote. He felt alienated by the middle class professional aspirations of his medical school cohort. With the young lords, by contrast, he felt home. I don't know exactly what there was about me and my personality that made me click so easily with a guy like Mikey Melendez or Yoruba Guzman. I think I come from a neighborhood that was so much like the barrio, wild ass kids running in the streets, playing ball, doing crazy things, .. So there was something about the way they were that was so resonant with my own experiences growing up, .. Also, I'm reading it off the thing, to be honest.
Hello?
Yeah, I said I'm reading it off the thing, so could you like scroll it up?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I was so confused. I'm like, wait, did my shit freeze?
No, you're good. You're good.
Okay.
I was white, unmistakably white, and a doctor too, but my distinctiveness disappeared. Osborne described the behavior of the radicalized doctors in ways similar to his description of the leadership of the young lords, but he seemed less intimidated by his colleagues. Despite our erratic behavior and arrogance, the workers came to like us because they felt at least we cared about the patients and were trying to do the right thing. Yeah. He also observed that the manner with which the Lincoln Collective doctors dealt with Ian Horn was extreme and unreasonable, and he attributed their inflexibility to the youthful inexperience. However, in discussing the authoritarian disposition of the young lords, Osborne also recalls that everybody was pretty sectarian in those days. That was the characteristic of most political groups that I knew of, which meant that they were running in a very hierarchical fashion. Most of the leadership was male. Middle class guilt figured prominently in the relationships among the groups in the Lincoln Coalition. According to Osborne, they would give us political education and sort of make us feel guilty about being white and middle class. Mullen explains the internal conflict he experienced over the notion that he should take a political lead from the young lords. I struggle with it on.
On the one hand.
Okay, I struggle with it on the one hand. I thought it was good to think creatively, and I definitely had the sense that there are always ways in which we needed to function differently as people in order to be responsive to people's movements. So I was at least open to the notion of considering my own elitism. Although they never made their position overt, the doctors, according to Milan, took issue with the analysis that third world people, and in particular third world workers, were the leadership, which was a little bit unrealistic in the sense that while you might like that to be the case, please scroll down for me, comrade.
Go.
Thank you. Third world workers, third people in particular, third world workers were the leadership, which was a little bit unrealistic in the sense that while you might like that to be the case, that doesn't necessarily mean that it's true. Just declaring it doesn't mean it's right, but most of us felt we had to accede to whatever the leadership of these minority groups asked of us because we felt guilty. Milan concludes that while the notion, Milan concludes that the notion that you have to surrender your identity or your leadership or your pride and take leadership from anyone who comes through the door because they're part of the party, dot dot dot, is not a viable way to run anything. For his part, Osborne often felt a bit guilty and a bit intimidated and a bit used, but he, end quote, but he believed that the good outweighed the bad. On the whole, we were doing the right thing. We had to move forward by having parties and leadership and cadre and rank and file and organizing and all that. And then another end. And I don't think I knew enough quite yet politically about how groups worked to really have a consistent analysis or a consistent critique of the coalition's experience with the doctor's young Lord Cleo Silvers. Young Lord Cleo Silvers emphasizes that many of them, especially the men, and they were mostly men, were never able to accept the notion that we could be equal partners because we were doctors. We weren't doctors ourselves. The notion that we could be equal partners, let me just reread that. Many of them, especially the men, and they were mostly men, were never able to accept the notion that we could be equal partners because we weren't doctors ourselves. They didn't truly get that you have to listen to the community in order to deliver quality health care. They couldn't overcome their middle class entitlement, and we struggled with them over this. The coalition work led by the young lords at Lincoln Hospital reflected the challenges presented by the demographic shifts of the post-war period. Lincoln employed and served members of a predominantly Puerto Rican and Black American population, and tensions among hospital activists were exacerbated by the chasm between the life experiences of the cohort of working class people of color with Vanguard Party politics, who made up the core of the TLC, and those of the group of politicized middle class white doctors who made up the Lincoln Collective. In a nation where middle class white professionals and poor people of color lived diametrically different lives, the workplace convergence of these two groups was bound to produce conflicts. On the one hand, white middle class professionals were beholden to a world managed by experts and a worldview that measured success through individual hard work, prudence, education, ambition, and self-improvement. By contrast, for many people of color, success was increasingly, you can just keep scrolling, it's all cool. Myself. Who says an individual are person? By contrast, by contrast, for many people of color, success was increasingly defined by individuals striving alone, but by their collect. By contrast, for many people of color, success was increasingly defined by individual strivings alone, but by their collective challenges to entrenched systems of oppression and grassroots campaigns for reform in education, health, and employment. In the context of growing claims to self-determination among people of color, there emerged critiques of less visible but no less damaging manifestations of racism and white paternalism among even progressive whites. Through 1970 and 1971, the Young Lords continued their coalition work at the Lincoln, and in November 1970 became involved in another major action. Thank you. In the lead up to the action, the HRUM became an official subsidiary organization of the Young Lords, which meant that its members identified both as Young Lords and as HRUM members. This granted the Young Lords greater reach and political influence at Lincoln, even amid administrative attempts to limit their access to the hospital after the Lincoln occupation in August. In August, the Young Lords and HRUM bought together a desperate, disparate, I don't know, a group,
Disparate. Disparate.
disparate, okay,
Oh, the
disparate group of seven neighborhood organizations in a collaboration they called the South Bronx Drug Coalition. Its objective was to obtain institutional backing from Lincoln Hospital for a drug detoxification center following the dominant community control model of protest of the period of that period. On November 6, 1970, the activists again occupied the sixth floor of the nurses' residence attached to Lincoln. There they proceeded to implement a program with the aid of doctors. The group of conducted phys physicals. The group conducted physicals. Assigned beds and began to administer detoxification treatment, while representatives of the coalition negotiated with Lactel
a coat.
Lecote At the end of the day, the police were called in and 15 people were arrested. But others returned the next day and proceeded to lay the groundwork for a detoxification clinic. The group became popular among the people of the South Bronx because it humanized the user and challenged the notion of addiction as a personal character flaw. The Young Lords and others involved sought to understand the relationship between individual behavior and social context and structure of society. The identification of drug abuse as a social rather than a purely individual phenomenon was considered an integral component of the rehabilitation process. In a district that claimed the largest incidence of drug addiction in the nation, before long, what came to be known as Lincoln Detox was treating 600 people a week. Through political education and program and the programs through political education, the program's treatment empowered users with an understanding of the complexity of addiction, including the socio-political context that led people to want to escape reality. Poverty, parliament, nah, poverty, permanent unemployment, racism, and a dilapidated living environment. The mandatory education classes also introduced their participants to a web of political ideas that highlighted the intersection between drug addiction and the expansion of drug trafficking as a consequence of U.S. foreign policy in places such as Vietnam. The detox program involved doctors, activists, and patients as partners in a multifaceted medical treatment and social rehabilitation project. Appreciate it. Directed by Steven Levin and Cleo Silvers, the program first adapted of necessity. The mainstream methadone detox method was unpopular with activists because methadone could be just as addicting as heroin. The activists sought an alternative that didn't replace one addictive substance with another. Before long, they came to envision a program that could introduce Eastern medicine as the primary treatment method for addiction. Lincoln Detox was eventually funded by Lincoln Hospital in 1972 and became one of the principal acupuncture drug treatment centers in the Western world. The fast-paced course of activism initiated by the Young Lords at Lincoln used a range of tactics to involve workers and patients in the fight for better wages and improved care. The multiplicity of tasks from rallies and petitions, the complaint table, and negotiations with hospital and administrators to building occupations and door-to-door home visits demanded a full-time activism that was as exhausting as it was exhilarating. Together, the TLC, HRUM, and the Young Lords and the Lincoln Collective sought to elevate the ethics of medical practice by establishing a by establishing a compassionate, patient-centered, preventative model of care. They also sought to dramatize the problems of Lincoln and embarrass the city. To compel it to build a facility that had been promised to the people of the South Bronx 15 years earlier. The crisis over governance at Lincoln Hospital was a continuation, albeit in a different way, and albeit in a different sphere of the movement for community control that had exploded during the Ocean Hill-Brownsville school decentralization crisis of 1967 to 68. The growing call for community control was a radical interpretation of the war on poverty's dictum of maximum feasible participation. Quote, maximum feasible participation, end quote. The concept demanded a recording of. Okay, I need to bring it along. Where was I? The growing call for community control was a radical interpretation of the war on poverty's dictum, quote, maximum feasibility participation, end quote. The concept demanded a recording, a reordering of decision-making, employment patterns, and delivering of local services in the majority institutions, growing governing community life, such as schools, hospitals, and police precincts. The call for minority control over community institutions was not a radical demand, but it was an expression of the radicalization and growing confidence of movements building by people of color in urban centers across the United States. It was also one of the major practical applications of the concept of Black power. It reflected a growing preoccupation among activists with extending the meaning of democracy and enhancing the fight for radical equality by rooting it in economic and political power at the local level. As the Lincoln example suggests, that demand was led by the growing sector of low-ranking workers in social service industries and municipal government, who were also often residents of the same community. The non-professional staff at Lincoln's mental health clinic also called for a community and work-led board of the clinic with authority to make and implement governing. Decisions and committed to fairly representing all staff. These activists raise issues of economic equality and wealth redistribution in their struggles, but in seeking greater influence and power over major political institutions, they often became managers of a system that had not granted the major structural reforms needed to address radicalized economic inequality. At Lincoln, the young lords broadened the definition of community control. Their campaign took the call a step further beyond a critique of the form of governance to a critique of its own content and purpose. The struggle at Lincoln evolved politically from one that emphasized the way in which racism colored health care services in the Bronx to one that articulated the social limitations of institutions governed by economic interests and how racism against people of color created deadly consequences. The dramatic work of the Young Lords and their supporters at Lincoln Hospital was driven by and corresponded to the deepening social and economic decay of the urban environment. Operating between two different epochs, the decline of the era of civil rights, black power, and the Great Society, and the emerging new era of social conservatism.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I wanted to ask what page were we on? Because the last thing that I wanted was for us to overread. But no.
You said page 305, right?
Yeah. We end at page 305. No, 304. God, I have such bad memory. Let me check again. Yes, we end at page 304.
Okay, did I finish reading? I don't even know if I finished reading.
Yeah,
I don't think you did.
No, I don't think. Yeah, the Young Lords were among the first activists to challenge draconian reductions in social spending and the associated privatization of public services. They were preparing for what they believe would be politically decisive battles. Okay, I got like two questions though.
Yeah.
So one is from earlier. I just didn't ask it because I just didn't feel like hopping in the conversation. But it was like, what's McCarthyism?
Basically, McCarthyism is essentially, okay, how do I try to explain it? Basically, McCarthy, the governor, senator, I forgot what exact government position he held. He was a heavy proponent of spreading false notions about the Soviet Union, and he basically lied, whitewashed, and made bourgeois anti-communist propagandists about the Soviet Union, that the Soviet Union was going to come after the United States, that they were planning to invade us, that communism means that that communism means when you don't have any food, when you don't have many houses, when you're stripped of your individuality, and so on and so forth. That's basically what McCarthyism is, and it started around the Cold War, if I remember correctly. So
yeah, that's essentially what McCarthyism is, and that's how you know they don't understand what communism actually is. Communism, in one word, is classlessness. Mm-hmm. That every single person, no matter what, has equal means of production, not only to means of production with everyone involved equally, but also equal access to food, housing, water, medical care, things like that. Essentially, it's a classless system. That's what essentially communism is.
Yes.
It's nothing bad.
Essentially.
It's nothing bad. It's nothing demonic. It's literally, essentially, everyone is on the same page and everyone has a say-so. Equally.
Exactly, yeah. And to add on to that, it's a classless, stateless, and moneyless society where resources are shared unconditionally, where there are no classes, just human beings, and where there's no longer a state. There's no longer a ruling system. There's no longer an oppressive reactionary upper class system. So it's a stateless, classless, moneyless society, and a lot of people. And to kind of help people understand what it is, socialism is from each according to their ability to each according to their work, and then communism is from each according to their work to each according to their needs. That's what it is,
Right.
basically.
That's it. Like that's that like that's literally it.
That's
And
interesting.
you said you had two questions, comrade?
Yeah, what's draconianism?
I have no idea. I have no idea what that is. When they said draconian, I thought,
Dracula.
yeah, no. When they said draconian, I thought they were talking about dragons or some shit.
I was talking about like a blood-sucking Dracula colonial thing.
I mean, I guess that's. I don't even know because I never even heard of it before. So, like, I'm kind of out of the loop.
Okay, I just searched it up. Of laws or their application excessively harsh and severe. Okay. So that's what it means.
Well,
There's some
essentially,
Dracula stuff.
like martial law, right?
Yeah, basically. So that's basically what they were talking about. So whenever she said draconian, she was talking about laws that were harsh, that were unfair, that were extremely repressive.
And oppressive.
I don't know why the fuck. I don't know why draconian. I don't know why that word is what it is. Like when I first heard it, I thought it fucking meant dragons. But yeah, apparently that's what it means. But wow, there's a lot to unpack from all of this. One of the first things that I really wanted to talk about was Osborne in that whole section where they mentioned about white middle class guilt and about how Osborne and some of the middle class people and how some of the middle class doctors didn't understand and felt it was unfair that colonized people were the ones that were leading the revolution, not them. And that's the same problem that we have today, you know?
Like, it
That's the
so
same exact problem.
me.
You were saying, Shanti, sorry?
It's so funny to me that Osborne said that because, like, a European American with a high standing in the class brackets, having the audacity to say that it's unfair that we're the ones leading the revolution and not them. Do
Fucking
you
ego.
not understand where you are? Do you not understand what neighborhood you're in? You're in the South Bronx. That's New Africans and Caribbean people, largely. Like, you can't be serious right now. Really? Really? Unfair? Unfair?
That's bullshit right there. Unfair. How the fuck is it unfair? Like, again, I've said this before, and I will say it again. How are we colonized people? How are we going to lead the revolution for decolonization when we have never been colonized? Like, how can we combat an oppression that we have never faced before? That is what I'm saying. All of these contradictions have to be combated. Every single last one, not just on an economic level, but on a social, political, and cultural level as well. We can't just ignore one facet of
Is
this system,
this
and care about another. Like, we can't. Like, it's just wild to me that he fucking said that shit. Because I'm like, are you serious? Like, how are you as a middle class colonizer doctor going to stop racism? You can't. You fucking can't. Like, I'm sorry, you can't.
literally
You
have
benefit from that system.
Yeah, and the fact that he was looking down on the lumpen, essentially, the petty criminals and drug users, the lumpen, literally degrading them, not understanding that the reason why they're even petty criminals and the fact that they are using drugs, poison, is because of the conditions that they are in, that they are disposables of the capitalist system and have to literally survive by, any means, or not even survive, just coping with it in self-destructive ways, like drug addiction. That's why the heroin epidemic was so bad. It was a pre once again, it was a precursor to the crack crisis the decade later. So, I mean, it already been a problem for 15, for about 15, 18 years at that point. But
Yep.
once again, Michael DeBoer of the Panther 21 in Capitalism Plus Dope Equals Genocide, he talks about this. He talks about African youth, Boricua youth, literally being collapsed under this epidemic because of the suffocating material conditions of poverty, of homelessness, not having to deal with the conditions of their housing, of police violence, to literally go to this vial of poison funded by the capitalists to not deal with the feelings of anything. Like it's literally not rocket science with this.
It's not. Not only that,
Why do you
not
think they're
only
so
that, I'm sorry.
Why do you think they're so strung out? Where do you think that's coming from? Why do you think they're stealing? Why do you think they rob people? Why do you think they why they commit sexual violence against children? Where do you think that's coming from? Because it didn't come from freaking outer space. It did not come from an individual being an individual. It did not come from that. An individual experience doesn't make you molest a child. It doesn't make you steal. It doesn't make you be so strung out on a vial of poison to not deal with the realities of the lumpen conditions. An individual experience doesn't do that. It doesn't.
It's systemic. That's why.
Like, look around you.
It's just wild to me that he fucking said that shit, because not only what you just said, Shanti, but for years, since the very foundation of quote unquote America as a settler colonial state. The very creation of America, settlers have been using drugs to deorganize, weaken, and oppress colonized people. They did that in the very beginning during westward expansion. They actively gave
They did that.
indigenous people alcohol to make them alcoholics. To break them apart from the inside and to destroy their communities
They did the
through
same thing
addiction.
to Hawaii. They did the
They're
same
doing
thing to Native Hawaiians. The same thing. And using cocaine against enslaved indigenous Africans to keep them working in the fields to get more cotton, to get, more sugar out of. Out of their labor while being in chattel enslavement, my ancestors, okay? And using crack as means of genocide in the 80s, because this was at the very, very height of social conservatism. The plight for assimilating was so high in the 80s, it's insurmountable. Making Chicanos into so-called Mexican Americans, making African people into so-called Black Americans, making Asian people into a model minority, making Indian people, Chinese people into a model minority to destroy any kind of revolutionary potential, especially between them and African people. That was at the very height of all of it. It was a train wreck of a decade. The AIDS crisis, the crack crisis, the fight for assimilating. I mean, it just collapsed on everyone. It collapsed on everyone. And the fact that they could say that we don't know what our struggle is. Really?
That's white saviorism right there. Literally. That's literally like, white saviorism.
Exactly. Like, you're not even committing class suicide. You're just blaming us for these things. You're just blaming us for everything because you're not seeing the bigger picture. At least you're not seeing where it's coming from. It's so funny to me. It's just so funny to me.
Excuse me, comrades. I have to leave. Is that okay?
No, yeah, of course. Of course, that's okay, man. No worries. If you have a situation where you have to go, that is completely fine. Don't worry.
Okay, for sure. And this is usually just like usually it's from like 2 to 4.
Oh, okay.
Are you asking how long these take?
Yeah, just so I know, because like usually I'm like free from 2 to 4, so like after 4 I usually have to like start going to my next
because these book clubs start at Sunday at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And after we're done reading the book, it usually depends on how long the conversation is and so on and so forth. But yeah, that's usually when we get done for the most part.
Yeah, I mean, it's no rush. It's not like, oh, we have to finish it up. But just like,
right.
Some days I may have to like leave around 4 and we, you know.
Yeah, you're good.
Of course.
For sure. It was nice talking to you guys and facilitating conversation with you all. Till next Sunday.
See you, comrade. Have a wonderful day.
You too. Have a wonderful day, both of you. Peace.
Peace right out. On.
But yeah, just the fact that Osborne fucking said that, she like, my guy, like, how can you say that? Like, once again, as Mao and Fanon articulated put it, the reason why there's so much petty crime, and why there is so much impoverishment among the lumpen proletariat, it's because of this capitalist imperialist system. It's because they are considered useless. They're not considered exploitable. That's why, and especially among colonized communities, the reason why there's so much impoverishment within those communities is because of the racial hierarchy, because of white supremacy, because of redlining, because of defunding those communities, those neighborhoods, and making the materials and conditions in those specifically worse, gentrification, and the bourgeois actively making colonized communities addicted to these drugs. And when I say addicted, I don't just mean addiction in a sense of alcohol, you know, coke and so on and so forth. I'm talking about these fast food fucking restaurants that feed you literal garbage. Fast food restaurants, bars, and so on and so forth. Have people always wondered why there always seems to be a lot of fast food restaurants in impoverished communities? They're intentionally put there because the bourgeois know that those impoverished communities have nowhere else to go or don't have a lot of options for where to get food. So what's the only option they have left? Going to these fast food restaurants that feed them garbage that has bullshit chemicals in them that are making them more addicted to this shit that's shortening their life. That's why there's so much impoverishment and petty crime within colonized communities, because this white supremacist, capitalist, imperialist, redlining, defunding bullshit. That's why.
That is why the fast food joints, the bars, the liquor stores, all of this stuff are put there to destroy the community's potential because of the conditions that were already there, they felt like the poor people feel like there's no real place for them in the world. Essentially, there's no way out. So they prey on these people on purpose, coming into their communities and putting a McDonald's right here and a Burger King right here and a Hardee's right here and two, three bars right here and a liquor store on this corner, to essentially feed into that doomism, to feed into that escapism that was fabricated by the bourgeois system. It's that simple. If you really want to see it for yourself, come to Chicago. Because everything that you will know about this system, you'll find in Chicago, because we have the most proletariat and weapon proletariats out of anyone. And the conditions in our history says that. That's why they hate us so much. That's why they degrade, especially Inglewood, where I come from, and very, very, very proud to be a part of, to come from. That's why they degrade us so much, because of that unique history that we have, that potential that we have. That's why that they come into these communities and destabilize us, because they don't want that potential to be seen. They want to make sure that poor people point the wrong thing, point their fingers at the wrong people. They want them to think like capitalists and literally make them so nihilistic and violent against workers, as you see on YouTube, as you see on social media. Literally go to war. That's essentially a part of it. Especially with the building of the new cop academy here in Chicago. Even though the community said multiple times that that we don't want this, but once again, the city never ever listens. But it's the native people's problem. Why? The McDonald's, there's so many McDonald's restaurants here. Why there's so many Burger King restaurants here? Why we're losing our jobs? Why we're losing our housing? Why we're being kicked out? Why these communities are being gentrified to fuck? Because they don't know how to fight. They don't know how to fight. They don't know how to think. They don't know how to get out of that escapism because it's so deep, deeply ingrained in those people. They prey on them in whatever way they could to keep them down. That's why there's still such high levels of alcohol usage in Native communities in these so-called reservations or concentration camps. And you see the result. They wonder why there's so much sexual violence happening. They wonder why there's so much gun violence happening. They wonder why these people are selling drugs, poison, to make ends meet. They wonder why we're so children are so freaking traumatized in another concentration camp, the schools under the system. As long as the system exists, school is a concentration camp, no matter where you go. No matter if it's college, no matter if it's high school, no matter if it's kindergarten, whether it's preschool, it doesn't matter because it's a stepping stone and making us subservient to capitalism and not deal with what's actually reality. That's the thing. They used alcohol, cocaine, heroin, fentanyl, speedball, which is heroin and cocaine together. Very, 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 very lethal.
Meth.
Meth, crystal meth, and other body destroying vials of poison that is still haunting us to this day. And it's and like I said, it's catching up to us in the worst way. Because we haven't been fighting for so long. We've just been relying on our culture to survive. Where has that got us? It got us disproportionate death rates of COVID. It got us more gentrification. It got us more gun violence. But we want to blame children for this. We want to blame the most oppressed people, the most oppressed facets of our community for this. And we want to keep pretending that them going to prison, that them going to these psych institutions is progress. It's not. No matter if a person actually murdered a loved one, no matter if they sexually violated someone, it doesn't matter, because prison exacerbates it. They make the condition so they can make it worse by justifying it. That's why these institutions are in place. But we don't understand that. We don't understand that. We keep thinking that it's an individual thing. No, it's not. It's never been. These people have been telling us that it's all our oppressors doing. No matter the color, no matter what they look like, no matter if they have a lumpen background or not, our oppressors are multilateral. The puppets in my homeland in Al-Kabalan of Africa, sucking us dry while they make money off of us, exacerbating the tribalism and the diseases that our oppressors introduced to us. It destroyed our ecosystems, which makes it worse. Malaria, AIDS, the Zika virus, all
sickle other. Cell.
Sickle cell. Like, it's not
lead poisoning.
Trait. It's not an evolutionary trait. It's a trait of oppression. That is what it is. It's medical oppression. It's medical genocide. It doesn't have to involve death in order for it to be genocide. Look at San Juan Hill in New York, what they did to that entire neighborhood to build the Lincoln Center. That's what a lot of people don't know. Look at Seneca Village, Central Park. You can literally put names of colonized people's places to these bourgeois creations, but not think a damn thing about it. Because why? Because, you know, they play jazz, our music. That's exactly why New York City is the way it is. We did not ask for these buildings. We did not ask for any of this. They didn't even come to the community to ask us. But that's the point. No matter how, if we ask or not, they are going to destroy our community. Just like the Obama, the presidential library for the war criminal Obama here in Jackson Park and Woodlawn, which is largely lumpen and proletariat, working class new African people. They took a whole sector of trees out. Trees that we need to breathe to build that library. I think they're still building that library. They didn't even ask the community. They didn't even ask. They didn't even negotiate with them. Nothing. But that's the point. They don't ask. They don't not ask. Because they want to make their world. They want to replace the African world with the oppressor's world. They want to replace the Chicano world with the oppressor's world. They want to replace the Boricua world with the oppressor's world. Just like what they're doing in Borican, just like what they're doing in Cuba, just like what they are doing in so-called Mexico, what they're doing in Hawaii, in Guam, in Samoa, what they're doing in West Papua. They wonder why we are so violent with each other. Why we're so isolated. And the fact of the matter is, once again, they will prey on us with any tactic in the book, even if it means recruiting poor people to work against other poor people, for homeless people.
The military.
The military. Recruit them in the military because they know that they could be killed too. They know that they would be discarded, that they would not even be a human anymore. There's whole videos of Vietnam veterans discarded and literally calling out the government for implementing them and sucking them dry, bringing them back into poverty, into homelessness, what they wanted to uphold in the name of so-called democracy. Richard Ramirez, who's a serial killer, which we might all know, his main influence was his older brother that was in the war, that was brainwashed, an indigenous Chicano person implemented into war and being brainwashed and getting off on bombing Vietnamese villages and sexually torturing Vietnamese girls and women, taking Polaroids of it, taking them back as their souvenirs, and showing young Richard those pictures and the stories of what they did to those women, what they did to those girls in the name of so-called democracy. That's why so many of Richard's victims were young Asian girls. Because of that. That is what colonialism entails. To be violent. To not have a care in the world. That is what it entails. That is the violence of war. That is the violence of imperialism. And it's poisoned us. Even little Richard. Why do they think that these serial killers are so freaking unique? Why? Is it because of some individual phenomenon that came out of space? No. Mind you, Richard was Chicano, and they implemented a lot of lumpen young Chicanos into that war, destroyed them, took their humanity, whatever humanity they had, away from them, made them proud to be violent, to torture those people that they don't even know. That's the violence that is so prevalent here. And they wonder why we even are in this predicament still. Years later, they wonder why we commit these so-called crimes. They wonder why we destroy each other, why we kill each other. Because of them. And the people that parade on this mess. That's exactly why. This is all a prime example of the violence of colonialism, like we talked about in Wretched of the Earth. It's nothing individual. It's systemic. It's the bourgeois doing. Even the colonizers are not protected, because that's the point. Everyone is a target. Everyone is
a tool.
Everyone is a tool. And these fast food restaurants and these bars and these liquor stores that seek to destroy us and our kids and our youth. This is exactly how we ended up here. It's not rocket science. It's real life. It's reality under the system. It's the system's doing. And anyone that is a diehard of the system, being completely unaware that they would be disposed next. That's the whole point. That's it.
Exactly. No one is safe. No one is protected under this system. It doesn't matter if you're colonized, if you're colonizer, if you are no longer exploitable, if you can no longer be used to uphold white supremacy, you're thrown away. You're discarded. You're treated as if you are nothing. These white supremacists that uphold this capitalist imperialist system, that think they're protected under it, they're only protected for as long as they are useful to the bourgeois. But the moment that they're no longer useful, the moment where their bodies have given out, the moment that all of that life and essence has been sucked away from it, where they can't even move or even think, they're thrown away. They're treated like nothing, and they're just left to rot without anything left. That's what the system does.
Right. Fighting for an identity that doesn't exist.
Exactly. That's one of the biggest atrocities that this system has brought upon humanity. Making us fight over something that doesn't even exist in nature. Doesn't even exist. This whole concept about race, this whole concept that humanity and that human beings are divided into quote-unquote different races, different species, that is downright fucking false. That is not true. There's no such thing as a white race. There's no such thing as a black race. It is not an actual scientific thing. It's not. Exactly. It is economic, it is social, and it is rooted within the very foundation that capitalism presides on. That's exactly. It.
That's it. That's literally it. And this is really important to note, that we have a class consciousness when we do say that race doesn't exist, because it's the immaterial that plays in with the material in the context of capitalism. Is not to be colorblind, but to understand reality and applying history to the current changing material conditions, and how to confront it, how to deal with it. It's not a matter of being blind. As long as you have that strong class consciousness to back that up, then you can make leeway with that. But, you know, not everyone is at that level. So you have to meet them kind of where they're at, and then you can say that. And then back it up with history to even prove that. Because if you just come at them with that, you know, they're going to think that you're just, you know, reducing, you know, the oppression, and you're going to scare them off. That's why I make it very, very clear. about that. That's why I don't use racial terms anymore, like to describe people, but I use them in class terms to describe the condition in which the proletariat people are in globally, not something that is actually based in reality. Only use racial terms as class terms to describe the condition in which we are in under a bourgeois world, under bourgeois dominance, under a bourgeois system. That is how
Jan.
you make a class analysis without trying to scare people away. Because once again, until we be able to get there, we have to meet them where they're at first. And then we can come in with that. And then they'll
Exactly.
eventually start to see, okay, how do we deal with this? That's what you're supposed to do. That's what you do. And the racialism with Boricuas racializing them as this monolithic people, even though they're not, it plays a role in their oppression. It plays a role in their conditions on the island and in the diaspora, largely within these borders. Like being mixed Taíno, being mixed Indigenous African, being Basque, being Irish, being Portuguese, that is an important facet to understand the condition in which Boricuas are in, or Boricanos. It's very important to have that aspect in there because it's a lot of history on that island. Even though it's just an island, it has tons of revolutionary history and a lot of cultural history, starting with the Taíno people. And I think there was another there was another indigenous group that were actually there first before the Taínos came. Forgot their name, but
Let me see it right here.
those people are still there. So it definitely does count. It definitely does count. Like it's literally not that hard to actually apply history to reality and how to, deal with it in a scientific revolutionary manner.
Exactly.
That's because,
Exactly.
the Lincoln Hospital, South Bronx, like you cannot separate it. It doesn't work because then you're just talking about two different things that seemingly have no connection to them. All of it has a connection in some way. Ableism has something to do with the Lincoln Hospital. Eugenics have everything to do with the Lincoln Hospital. Racism, racialism, gender based oppression, gender classism, gender fascism,
Misogyny.
misogyny, machismo, male chauvinism.
It all interconnects. Also, I just searched it up. I just saw it. There are two indigenous. There are actually three indigenous groups. In Boriken, the first are well, obviously there are the Taíno people. Then there are the, I hope I'm pronouncing this right, the Macoris. The
Oh,
Macoris
yeah,
people,
the Macaurties, yeah.
and then the other ones are the Siguayo people. I believe that's how I pronounce it. The
Yeah.
Siguayo.
Well, yep, they're there too. They're descendants for those people too. And these people, m the vast majority of them being descendants of native people, which still makes them native, no matter what.
Exactly. They're still
That
here.
aspect also plays a big role. The erasure of native people, of native history, because they seemingly disappeared out of nowhere, even though they're still here. That aspect is also very, very important. I was actually at the exhibit closing for the Women of the Ambulatory. at Hummel Park, at the Honeycomb.
Ooh.
It was like a very, very nice safe space for the Puerto Rican community that the pig capitalists are trying to, push out because of gentrification. And we talked about the exhibit, what it represented. Some of the Rainbow Coalition elders were there. I became very, very close with them.
Right on.
thank you. And we also talked with some of the women, three women in Borican alone on the ground fighting the colonialist powers on the island. And I asked a question because I believe they were open for questions. And I asked, I in my exact words, I said, "We know that the Taíno people are still here. We know that the Taínos are still very much here. We know they haven't left anywhere. We know that they haven't disappeared. How does the erasure of Taíno history, of Taíno roots, of Taíno history, essentially the oppression and the paper genocide of the Taíno people of Boricua, especially, play a major role in the ongoing colonialism and imperialism on the island?" That's what I asked. And they were blown away. Like
Really?
I mean, there were some finger snaps here and there because I showed up. I know that they're still here. We
Right
know that
on.
they were blown away by that. They were touched. And the honey, like, that place loves me.
I can see.
Every time I come, they would be so excited to see me because, they know that I'm on their side. They know that their ancestors are still here. They know that they are still keeping the spirit of the Taínos alive. They know that they're keeping their culture alive, revitalizing their language, with the new dictionary that came out. And they were just blown away by that. And the third woman, I believe the third woman, because they were in the order, the third woman really embraced her African roots, her Taíno roots to the core. Like, she was Afro-Taíno and proud of it. And I asked her specifically that question because I wanted to make it very, very clear to everyone, because they were also doing Instagram Live. I wanted to make it very, very crystal clear that the erasure of the Taíno people and the erasure of island native people plays a role in modern in the neo-colonialism of the Caribbean, but especially Boyden and Jamaica and Cuba and the Bahamas and Haiti or Quisqueya or Haiti and the Dominican Republic, how that plays a big role in the colonialism on those islands. And the fact I even asked that kind of question, because a lot of things are going on in Aguadilla, kind of like the tainting of the water there and the destruction of Taíno land, of very, very delicate Taíno spots. They could not believe that I asked a kind of question like that. And I think having that kind of discussion to uplift the seemingly invisible descendants of Native people, of those communities, of those peoples, including the Chicanos, Because, I mean, where do you think Chicano came from? So that native element is very, very important when we talk about this, because, you know, once again, the Dinos were the first ones to come in contact with Columbus when he came to what is now the Bahamas first, and then made his way down to still be here after all of the oppression, the attempted mass genocide, the labor, the exploitation, to still be here. That is a very, very, very crucial element of talking about the material conditions of the Puerto Rican, because even with, you know, them having Taíno bloodlines, they also have to face hatred of their African identity, of their African roots, of their African bloodline, their Yoruba bloodline, especially because the indigenous Yoruba people have a big influence in Boykin and Cuba, obviously. Having that element of racialistic oppression and racialistic systems of oppression is very important to note why the Lincoln Hospital was such in terrible condition. Because when they came up, they were embracing an identity that they didn't even make, that wasn't even their own. You know, like the pigmentocracy, the machismo, the racialism, the misogyny, all of these things, the ableism, all of these things play a big role in the condition of the Boricua here within these borders, because there's already been a few deaths of Boricua people in the hands of pigs and fascists within these past 2 months, including a Boricua 8-year-old that was shot and killed by a deranged fascist neighbor because she was too loud.
I remember that. I remember that. Yeah.
Too loud. Who were the first ones to be called too loud? Who?
African people.
And
Yep. And indigenous people. Yep.
what specifically, indigenous people in this type of situation?
Right. The Taíno people.
Yes.
Exactly. They were
That
one of the
belief.
first ones. Too loud, too noisy, too.
Loud.
That all stems from the colonizers being afraid of rebellion, being afraid of their resilience, of them fighting back
The
against
belief.
white supremacy and colonization, settler colonialism. That's what it
Exactly.
is, and exactly as you were saying, Comrade Shanti. Because when we say race does not exist, we're not saying in a sense of being colorblind and class reductionist. Of course not. And that's fucking that would be harmful to the movement.
Right.
And as you were saying before about the immaterialist, that people need to understand is that thoughts are not just metaphysical. Thoughts don't just come out of nowhere, but thoughts come from your interaction with your materialistic conditions. What you
Your
learn, what you see, the people they have around you, who you're educated by, that is what determines your thoughts, your sentiments, what you believe in. That heavily influences you. That's what determines your thoughts. Thoughts are based on our materialistic conditions. The whole concept of race first came due to the bourgeois wanting to oppress, exploit, and subjugate the masses to make profit. First came the idea of profit, then came the idea of race. That's how it happened. That's how it fucking happened.
That's exactly what happened. And
that thought of race came from the materialistic conditions that these bourgeois have of wanting to maximize profit through any means necessary. And what's the best way to maximize profit? By having one set of people fight another set of people because they think that they're not human. Because they think that they're a different species, that they're not a
human.
Exactly.
Be considered not human. And this plays a big role in that 8-year-old being killed. The belief that Boricuas are too loud, that colonialists lie.
That white supremacists fucking lie right there. And this system perpetuates it to this very day. Those thoughts, they don't just come out of nowhere. People say, you know, I always hate it when liberals, especially, they fucking say, oh, that was in the past, but it's still happening today. It is still happening today. Nothing has changed.
Don't cause
those
it.
Thoughts,
don't cause
those
it.
Thoughts, nothing has changed. Those thoughts that people have, those racist, fascist, white supremacist thoughts, they are still here because those thoughts come from a capitalist, imperialist, socioeconomic system. They come from the materialistic conditions that are brought on by the system. And it is only exactly. So if we want to meet the people where they're at, if we want to radicalize them, if we want to help them engage in a class analysis, we have to meet them where they're at materially and psychologically, because thoughts derive from our materialistic conditions. So if the masses see, interact with, and are surrounded by reactionary forces, they're going to be reactionary. But if they're surrounded, engaging, and are with revolutionary forces, they'll be revolutionary. Human beings are social creatures. Everything that is learned can be unlearned, and relearning can take place. And how do we make people relearn? How do we enable them to unlearn being psychologically colonized? By meeting them where they're at psychologically, through cultural revolution, through educating them that things ought to be this way, through actually giving them political education on why things are the way they are, how they even got to this point.
To give them that fight again, that rage.
Exactly.
Turn it
That's
into
what we gotta do.
Love. That's the point. To make them feel that they do have a place in this world. To make them feel that there is a real place for them, that they are wanted, that they are valuable, that they are human, and they can be allowed to be human. They can be able to live their life without having to be so stressed out under a system that is not built for them.
That they're loved.
Single mothers especially, because, you know, they do face the biggest brunt of it.
Oh, 100%. You know, if a man is single, he's considered a bachelor. But if a woman is considered single, she's demonized for
right.
it. She's belittled.
And that's cis heteronormativity that needs to be dismantled completely, because we never operated this way. But that's the point. They created gender once again to, for profit, essentially. We were given the titles of man and woman, boy and girl, so-called male and so-called female, in order to, you know, justify their oppression on us. So it definitely is an African issue. It is an African issue. It's not race first. That's 100 years ago. We're talking about now. We're not talking about what Garvey said 110 years ago. We're not. No. Everything has an intersection under a bourgeois system, no matter how much you separate it from each other.
Everything is interconnected. Everything. Nothing is divided. Nothing is the way it is because it's just like that. No, It doesn't, it's not, things are not just like this because they just happen to be this way. That is, that they were just always this way, that nothing has changed, and that society has just been fucked up. That's not what happened, because if that was the case, like you said, if everything was static, we'd all be dead. We'd all, we would, static, staying still. No fluidity means death. That's what that means. Nothing is static. Nothing is motionless. Everything is constantly moving. Things didn't get this way because they've just always been this way. No, it comes from the socioeconomic system. And the moment that people understand that, the moment people have that principled dialectical and scientific analysis of the internal contradictions between society, the relation between those contradictions, how said contradictions affect their materialistic conditions, their thoughts, their sentiments, and how to engage in organizing and agitating to combat those contradictions and to build new institutions and a new society, to unlearn that bourgeois thought through praxis. That all comes from meeting the people where they're at psychologically, materially, and political education. It comes through observation and participation. That's where it all
Exactly.
starts. If you don't have observation and participation, you have nothing.
We have nothing, and the Lincoln Hospital and the Young Lords and the Black Panther Party and gender oppression amongst African people of marginalized and exploited gender experiences. Those are prime examples of that. Those are big prime examples of that because there is still gender fascism within African people, especially here. It's really, really bad here. Like the adultification that we undergo to make us more and more so-called mature. That plays a role into sexual violence as well in our community. So to deal with that class aspect is very, very crucial. And what happened to Carmen Rodriguez, what happened to her, those colonialist beliefs.
That was racist. Literally, that
It was
guy, that fucking doctor, he literally said that he literally said that he thought she had asthma. Because quote, most Puerto Ricans have asthma. That's literally the rest. That was really racist fucking beliefs. The idea that all Puerto Ricans are the same. They're just a monolith.
Like, that's the beliefs that kill us. Those are the beliefs that kill us. Why do you think so many Puerto Ricans have asthma? Because of colonialism, tuberculosis, thrombosis. Where do you think that came from?
Colonialism. That's where it fucking came from.
And the fact of the matter is that it doesn't matter if they're intern or not. They are engaging in an institution that makes them still have these colonialist beliefs because it's health business, not health care, health business that literally kill us every single day. And Carmen is a prime example of that, the sterilization of Boricua women, of Boricua migrants. This plays a big role in that. A big, big role. African women being strong and not having to feel pain. This is shit that we still go through. And the fact of the matter is, they think, because of whatever they believe, that we are all this type of people, but they don't understand why. They don't want to deal with the why. It's that why question that makes a big difference in all of this. A big fucking difference. Like, come on.
And colonizer people still holding on to that petty bourgeois white privilege of theirs, it results in people like Osborne in feeling offended that they are not the ones leading the revolution, that their presence within the revolution is not on par or higher than colonized right. people. Right. That's what I've been that right there. That is why saviorism and white privilege. That is why if you are a colonizer person, if you want to engage in the revolution, you have to betray your white privilege. You have to become a class traitor, because if you don't, it leads to you being like Osborne. It leads to these conflicts between colonizer and colonized people. It leads to there being disagreements because one group feels offended and feels bad for being a being a settler and feels angry that they're not leading the revolution. This is why as colonizer people we have to betray our white privilege, because if we don't, there will be more conflict. And Osborne is a prime example of that. And funnily enough, I just find it funny that there are so many difficult problems with these petty bourgeois middle class doctors, because one of the greatest revolutionaries that ever lived, Che Guevara, started off as a petty bourgeois doctor, you know?
Right.
So I find that funny.
Yeah, it's that historical aspect. It's that historical aspect that, like, that's why class suicide is called class suicide.
Exactly.
You're betraying your class, your high class standings, and be in reality and struggling not only with yourself, but with the people. That is what it means. That is what it means. It means finally acknowledging who you actually are and understanding that anyone is a target and anyone is a scapegoat under this system. And you have to betray your privilege that upholds it. Period.
That's what it takes. That's what it takes. Exactly. And again, that self-flagellation that Osborne and other petty bourgeois doctors had. Once again, no one is telling them to feel bad for being quote unquote white. No one's telling them to feel bad for being a settler.
That's not
exactly. That's not what colonized people say. They're not telling you to feel bad for who you are. They're telling you to listen to them, struggle alongside them, and be with them and be to them arm to arm. To live their experience and see things through their perspective. That's what they're saying. They're not telling you to feel bad. They're telling you to do something about the system by struggling alongside them and showing that you actually give a fuck. That's what colonized people say. Not to feel bad about yourself. No one can choose what family they were born into. No one can choose their ancestors. No one can choose what skin color they're born with out of the womb. But what you can choose is whether or not you are willing to uphold this white supremacist system. It's whether or not you're willing to continue the exploitation, oppression, and subjugation of the masses for your own personal privilege. That's the choice that you have. And whether or not you are going to uphold it or betray it, that is your decision. And if you're going to betray it, if you're going to betray that system, you have to betray your white privilege. You cannot claim to be for liberation when you still benefit from that system of oppression. It's impossible. You can't do that. You're either for it or against it. Simple as that.
That's it. That's it. That's it. And we need to learn from like the Lincoln Hospital takeover to understand these things. Because it doesn't happen from outer space. Under the system, everything has a reason for why it even is the way it is. South Bronx, Chicago. It doesn't take rocket science. It doesn't.
All designed. It's all designed for the purpose of a small group of people. That's a design.
That's it. So either actually look at history and actually get with the struggle or just move on the side.
I really hope that we're probably going to go over the next chapter, but I really hope that the contradiction between the young lords and the fucking and the petty bourgeois white doctors, I hope that gets settled, and I hope Osborne gets his head out of his ass.
we'll just hope. Just hope.
We'll hope. Like I just really love this chapter and all the things that they go over. What the young lords did, that is how you radicalize people. That is how you do it. Meeting them for their materialistic conditions, meeting them where they're at, and once they see that you give a fuck about them, once they see that you're for the people, once they see that the Vanguard Party is for the masses will follow alongside the Vanguard Party. They will begin adopting the ideological and political line of the Vanguard Party. They will respect and engage in the revolutionary activities of the party. That's the result of every single successful revolutionary party. The Bolsheviks, the PRC, the Black Panthers, the Young Lords, American Indian movements, they were all successful because they met the masses where they were at. And the masses respected that, and they did what they did. Observation and participation. If the party didn't meet them where they're at, the masses wouldn't have done jack fucking shit. They wouldn't have followed them. They will have just saw them as another group saying high expectations, but not actually being sincere and just not engaged with them. You have to meet the people where they're at. If you don't do that, they're not going to follow you. They're not going to respect you. It does not matter. It does not matter how many guns you have. It does not matter how much power you have. You can have all the power behind you, but if you do not have the correct ideological and political line, your movement's nothing. It will get destroyed. It will get ransacked, and it will never go anywhere. Ideological and political line determines everything, and not just having a correct ideological and political line, but adapting to your ever-changing materialistic conditions, adapting to them through praxis. Praxis changes theory. If praxis is the knife, theory is the whetstone. The whetstone sharpens the knife, and then the knife is able to better engage in cutting and slashing. But once that blade gets dull, you gotta resharpen it.
Yep. And that's what we gotta do.
We gotta resharpen our blades.
Yep.
That's what we gotta do. We gotta meet the people where they're fucking at.
And that's it.
This conversation has been amazing, and that whole thing that you went to, that whole event that event you went, that Borican event, that was awesome. That was beautiful. Like goddamn, like how I can see why they were amazed they even asked that question, you know, because being like, yeah, everything they said was 100% correct. This system prides and completely engages in the erasure of indigenous people, the complete whitewashing of their history, and portraying as if they never existed. And I believe you and Sally Mae were having a conversation one time, and both of you were saying that due to white supremacy and colonization and being psychologically colonized, other indigenous groups don't accept Taino people for being indigenous. They ostracize them and they portray them as if they're not even indigenous because of the fact that indigenous people and the African people who rebelled and met the Taino people intermarried with each other and had children and had Afro Taino descendants.
Like hello.
It's sickening. That right there, the complete erasure of indigenous groups portraying as if their culture is just completely gone. And not only that, but demonizing them for also having Afro roots. That right there is neocolonialism. That right there is pitting indigenous people against one another.
Especially with the Chicano people, because I went to the Mexican Independence Day parade, and you know, we know that Mexico is a settler state, you know, we know that. But I went to one of the main Chicano neighborhoods in Chicago, South Lawndale, or you know, more arbitrarily Little Village, because Little Village came from Chicanos assimilating and wanting to separate from African people. So I only say South Lawndale. I went to South Lawndale for the first time, actually walking in South Lawndale after the parade was over. And there was so many native faces. You could tell that they are not from Europe. You see native faces everywhere. Even at the restaurant that we were at, native people. Native. To here. So, the fact of the matter is that because a lot of them don't actually know their roots, or been so politically disconnected from their bloodline, that's why they have so much discourse over identity and detribalized people reconnecting, because they think that they're trying to take up space. No, they're not taking up space. They are reclaiming what colonialism stole from them. Now do a lot of them attempt to jump over the decolonizing aspect? Yes, they do. But it doesn't change their bloodline. It doesn't change their bloodline. It does not. Being mestizo does not change your native bloodline. And seeing, like, being in another native barrio, because once again, this was my first time in South Lawndale, seeing all those native faces around, native children, in the form of their colonial arbitrary identities, was really eye-opening. And, you know, even with the assimilation that happened, those people embraced me with open arms. Even when we went to a block party before we went to Humble Park for a queer picnic, and I mean, I was talking about my liberation school, and I was playing my cowbell, and they were, you know, egging me on. They were egging me on because, you know, I was very gentle with them. And they loved me, and they when I was talking about the Liberation School, they were literally shook. Like a 19-year-old making Liberation School, and these were other organizers, other youth organizers as well. So it was kind of like making that strong alliance again. Making it strong again, you know, in conjunction with the Second Rainbow Coalition and stuff like that. Bringing Chicago's revolution back to make it clear that we are back and here to stay. And that no kind of infiltration will stop us, even like even in the form of what happened in the First Rainbow Coalition, the original, the one that started it all. We're not going anywhere. And so kind of being around so many Native people. That was the most Native people I've ever walked around, including Humboldt Park. But South Lawndale was the kicker, because you could tell that they were not Spaniard. You could tell that they were not Latin. They're Native. Or Afro-Native. You can tell.
Exactly.
Like, it's just, it blew my mind. It blew my mind. Literally, because they have been through so much trauma and violence with being so ripped away from their Native identity and from their African identity, if they have any African blood in them, to be so stripped of that, with the bloodline still there, but the identity not being there, that really showed a lot to me. Just how much identity genocide had happened to these people. And also, it was also Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador's Independence Day yesterday as well. But especially with Guatemala, like, there's nothing to celebrate, because the Mayan people have been so annihilated. Many of them either identifying as mestizo or Afro descendants being lumped into that mestizo identity and not even being counted by that system.
That's fucking disgusting.
And the genocide that happened in the 80s, I believe. You know about that genocide, right?
The 1980s?
Yeah.
I'm not sure. Mind telling me?
Okay, so the colonial boundaries that make Guatemala are the Mayan people.
Mm-hmm.
You can put two and two together. What happened?
Yeah.
It was devastating. Like, it was bloody. It was ruthless. It was abhorrent. Many of them don't want to identify as Native because of this. And that is what so many tribalist people don't understand. It's not their fault that they can't reclaim their Native bloodline because of these systems. You're in that same system too.
Mm-hmm.
They're not taking up space. It's millions of people with native bloodlines that don't even know who they are. Because of Mestizaje, because of Latinidad, because of Black Quantum. I mean, Mestizaje is essentially the same way. It's essentially the same way. Just like how Black Quantum determines how native you are. Mestizaje is exactly that.
It's but bullshit.
It's bullshit. And the Mayans never operated this way. Never, ever, ever. Because this was before colonization. So, like, they never operated this way.
Exactly.
They never operated this way. And when colonization happened, like, it just tore them apart. It tore them apart. Even though they're still here, and, you know, many, you know, a lot of people are trying to actually reconnect with their native identity step by step, because it is a process to have years of your history wiped away like that. Especially with indigenous Africans, because, I mean, we've been here since the very beginning, and so much of our history has been so distorted and so just erased. Many traditions that we never even practiced until colonization. So that aspect of it is also very important to note. Cultural genocide is why Lincoln Hospital was the way it was, and probably still is. Why there's such dissent between the Puerto Ricans on the island and in the diaspora. Why there's so much tribal politics between communities and descendants. It didn't happen out of nowhere. And that's what they don't want to understand. That's really what they don't want to understand. So having that aspect is not only crucial to African people, but to indigenous people and descendants of their communities. Because it's a step into not only understanding who they actually are once and for all, but to also take that in changing the material conditions in which they are in, you know, using their bloodline, using their history as a mode of revolution, which is what you're supposed to do. That's what cultural revolution entails. Using culture
all about.
As revolution. And that is what we have to implement. That's what we have to implement. Because if, you know, we don't have those systems to know who, what our history is, to know what our actual enemy is, just like Sister Soldier said, we will constantly be going to other people's parties to, you know, kick our asses and get them to like us, essentially to make nice, like we've been doing under the system. And it hasn't got us anywhere. So being able to reconnect and decolonize who we are is a big stepping stone in that. And the mass lines is what it takes for that to actually to off.
That's what it takes. struggle alongside the people and meeting them where they're at, and then taking the scattered idea of the people and transforming it into organized action. And I've said before, I'll say again, it does not matter who you were colonized by. It does not matter if you're in the Anglosphere or in the Latin sphere. You are still indigenous. That does not erase your roots. That does not erase your ancestors. That does not erase where you came from. That erases nothing. Regardless if you are a new African person in the Anglosphere or in the Latin sphere, it doesn't matter if you're Afro-Cuban, if you're Afro-Borican, if you're Afro, whatever, you are still African. You're still you. That does not erase anything that does not erase anything of your culture, of your roots. It erases nothing. Decolonization needs to happen all across the board. And dealing with and combating neocolonialism and actually educating people on why things are the way they are through cultural revolution, through political education, through mass line, through survival programs, through helping them, through elevating them to apply a dialectical materialist analysis, a class analysis, a scientific analysis,
exactly,
and have them engage in practice. That's what it's going to take, because the only difference between an Afro-Cuban, an Afro-Puerto Rican, a new African person, being Haitian, being Bohemian, being Yoruba, the only difference is where that ship landed. That's the only difference.
That's
but
the
your
only...
roots stay intact,
right? Like, we still, like, we are, like, we're not just Yoruba, we're not just Igbo, we're also other roots that were caught in the Maafa, in the Holocaust, in that so-called trading of slaves, even though we're not slaves, we were kidnapped.
It was human trafficking.
It was human trafficking. It was trafficking of indigenous Africans, the cradle of life. That is who we are. We are a kidnapped. We are descendants of kidnapped indigenous people brought here. And, you know, like they say, like, we had history here before colonization. I don't care. I don't give a fuck. I don't care. Because that's not even supposed to be the question. That ethno-revisionist question. I don't care. Because it's not the matter of if we had history here or not. I don't care. The real question is, where do we stand in the now? Where do we stand? Because, like, and this is also an important aspect, repiecing our history. Because, you know, once again, so much of it has been so distorted and so destroyed that, you know, we're only reclaiming bits and pieces of it. It doesn't matter. We are still African people. We're still African people, no matter what. Nothing is our bloodline. Nothing changes our roots, our indigenous roots from Africa, of course. Nothing changes that. And that's what we need to understand, reclaiming our indigeneity. Because, you know, Hoodoo, Voodoo, those are re-indigenized traditions. Meaning that we've kept them alive. It was revitalized by the people under chattel enslavement and revived and survived. Revitalized. That's why New African has its name. That's why it has its name. Now we're a mixture of these groups. We may not, I mean, we could pinpoint, you know, where our DNA starts with what group, but we're now a mixture of these groups. And our culture, especially with the hunter-gatherer peoples, like, we have heritage from them too. The Baka people, the San people, the Kojin people. We also have heritage from them. So they haven't left. We're still here through them. We're just a mixture of them now. I mean, that's all that is.
Exactly. And that and what you were mentioning before about ethno-revisionists trying to say that they had history in Turtle Island before colonization. If I remember discussions that I've had with Comrade Kwame, that whole talking point stems from self-hatred with being African.
Right.
Because they're trying to say, well, we're not African. We came from here. Our roots are here. That's a colonialist ideology. That being African equals bad, right. and that bad equals African.
That's not who we are.
Exactly.
I mean that's bullshit. I don't care, because once again, that's not even supposed to be the question. The whole thing with that also stemming from the fact that they've kidnapped five different native peoples, one of them the Choctaw, my tribe, one of my ancestral peoples, which I'm very proud to have heritage from. On top of being African, of course.
Right on.
Kidnapping them to a different place that they didn't even grace, and calling them quote unquote civilized. But they were already civilized. The Mississippian civilizations. The Choctaw people were in the civilization of Palcomine, which is essentially like the area which makes modern day southern Arkansas, West Tennessee, the Delta, and East Louisiana, but especially South Louisiana. That's where they came from. And they were kidnapped with the Indian Removal Act and just annihilated their identity, made them European, and had them engage in enslaving us. And they wonder why there's such dissent between African people and Native people because of what happened. But it didn't happen out of nowhere. The colonizers did it. And so many of us think that because Native Americans, that so-called Native Americans, have made so much leeway, which is a lie, that they're doing more better than our people, which is a lie. That is a lie. They're still having problems with their water, with their resources, with alcoholism, with sexual violence, just like us. Is not a competition. And the fact that they want to revise history so bad, like, that shows you how far colonialism will go, because they want us to think that there was never anyone on our side, and it was all just a separate struggle from us, and we had nobody, and blah blah blah, and bullshit like that, even though it's a lie. And that is something that we do need to combat now, together, especially because, I mean, that's why we have these classes, to confront the ugly truth. It will
exactly.
be ugly. It will not be pretty. It will not be nice. But that's the point. In order to move forward, we have to confront history. In order to confront history, we have to confront all of it. It will not be nice. That's the point.
Exactly.
It will open old wounds. It will open up old wounds, historical wounds. It will not be pretty to confront reality, but that's what we have to do in order to
right on.
Revolution happen. Because, I mean, everyone got played. And you have African people thinking that there was never anyone on our side, that they inherently hate us, even though that came from the bourgeois system. Like, that's why we confront history in all facets, so that everyone's on the same page again. Once again, it won't be pretty. That's the point. You have to confront it. You have to confront the real enemy. You have to confront the real culprit. That's what you're supposed to do. That's what we're supposed to do, right?
Exactly. And with what you were saying, they want to give different colonized groups, different whitewashed history to instill in them internal hatred within their group to push down bourgeois reactionary thought and ideology, and to encourage individualistic behavior to further colonize and psychologically destroy groups by teaching them a reactionary colonial history, and to embolden bourgeois thought. But they never teach they never teach us in school of the hundreds, or if not hundreds, of the dozens of slave revolts that took place of both African and indigenous people fighting alongside each other to combat white supremacy here. They never teach us that.
Right.
They never teach us that at all.
Right.
These
there's a indigenous Igbo New African street historian that talks about these rebellions, because they never be talked about. And this man is of Igbo heritage, because I believe he's in Virginia. So, you know, there are a lot of Igbo descendants in North Carolina and Virginia especially. And he talks about Igbo history and, you know, like these rebellions of enslaved indigenous Africans and the native peoples, you know, against, you know, the bourgeois traffickers. So, like, it's a whole facet of history that we don't know, that they don't want us to know. So that aspect is very, very important, because it tells history from a more open-ended train of thought, and not just thinking with your eyes.
Exactly. Conceptual knowledge over perceptual knowledge. Actually having a historical dialectical analysis on what actually transpired. That's what we have. That's what we gotta have. We have
Right.
to, in order for us to combat the now, we have to understand how it even got to this point. We have to understand the actual history of why things are the way they are. We have to engage in historical materialism to understand the history of these different contradictions that are inherent to capitalism, racism, misogyny, queer phobia, ableism,
Right.
and so on and so forth. If we don't understand where they came from, if we don't understand how they are intrinsic to this class, socioeconomic, capitalist, imperialist system, then we will never win. And we will never be able to establish a new system. We gotta
Exactly.
know how we even got here. And in
Exactly.
order to do that, we have to re-educate the people. We have to re-educate the
From the bottom up.
uneducated, sorry,
From the bottom up.
from the bottom up. As I don't know which comrade said it, but they said we're not left nor right. We're at the bottom and we're coming for the top. That's what we're gonna do.
Yep.
We have to
Happen.
educate the uneducated and re-educate the miseducated. That's what we
Yep.
gotta do.
Yep.
It all starts with education. And that's what the bourgeois fear. They fear colonized groups stop fighting amongst themselves. They fear colonized groups actually being able to psychologically decolonize themselves, of having internalized hatred, and of having a bourgeois whitewashed thought to encourage reactionary individualistic behavior, and to stop colonized people engaging in their own oppression by joining the state. They fear when colonized people actually work together, and what they fear even more than that is when colonized and colonizer people actually start working together.
Yep. And that's what we got to make happen.
That's what we gotta make happen. All of us need to be liberated. To kind of bring back to that to bring it back to that whole Osborne thing where he felt offended where he felt offended that colonized people are the ones that are going to be leading the revolution. Karl Marx himself said that for the British proletariat to be liberated, the Irish proletariat has to be liberated. And Lenin said that for the great Russian proletariat to be liberated, the Ukrainian proletariat must be liberated. On a global scale, on a global class scale, if the colonizer proletariat wants to be liberated, the colonized proletariat must lead that liberation. They have
Right.
to. They a colonized pe colonizer people are so fucking upset that they're not leading the revolution when they fail to realize that if the revolution is not led by the colonized, they'll still be oppressed under this system.
Exactly.
They'll still be oppressed by it. You can't just change the economic system and ignore the social and the political and the cultural aspects. You can't ignore that. Because if you do, if you ignore the secondary contradictions, it will lead to the formation of the primary contradiction, or the secondary contradictions will become primary contradictions. You
Yep.
cannot just ignore. You can't just ignore one aspect of the system because it makes you uncomfortable. If all of it isn't uprooted and combated, if even a fraction of it is left to still be in our society, whether it be culturally, economically, socially, politically, if bourgeois sentiments are left to fester back, it will lead to the reformation of the capitalist road. That's what's gonna happen. The majority of times that revolutionary movements have fallen, it has been from within. from internal contradictions that were not resolved. That's the majority of why they failed. And I believe I mentioned this before, even with the Black Panther Party, the Rainbow Coalition, even though the COINTELPRO were primarily the ones that resulted in these movements to be to fail, they took advantage of internal conflicts that were happening within
right.
these movements.
That's
they,
what Asada pointed
that's
out.
What they did.
That's what Asada pointed out in her autobiography. And like, if you ever want to know about the internal conflict, read Asada's autobiography, because you're gonna get the basic of what happened inside.
Exactly.
So
that whole petty thing, that little well not little but that that beef, I can't think of a better word, but that beef between Huey P. Newton and Eldridge Cleaver, if I remember correctly, that was perpetuated by COINTELPRO.
Right.
That was perpetuated by them. The idea that to vote people into office to cause systemic change, the COINTELPRO took advantage of that. Huey P. Newton's Huey P. Newton's further isolation from the party and his crack, and he became addicted to crack, correct?
Yeah.
That was the doing of COINTELPRO. They actively look for internal conflicts within these movements, unsettled internal contradictions, petty disagreements, exacerbate it. They make it seem bigger than it actually is. They try to misguide and misdirect the masses by portraying small disagreements as colossal contradictions to try and misdirect, misconstrued, misguide, and revise the original intentions and the original ideological and political line of the party. That's what caused the split between the East Panthers and the West Panthers.
Yep.
That's what caused it. COINTELPRO, feeding off of those internal contradictions that were not resolved yet. That's why the West Panthers became revisionist. That's how they ended up falling down that revisionist, reformist line. Because COINTELPRO took advantage of those internal contradictions that were not resolved, that
right.
were not uprooted, and they ended up becoming revisionist.
Right.
The West Panthers went from encouraging self-defense and self-determination to telling people to go vote for office, portraying as if that is revolutionary, when in actuality it's not. Revisionism.
They abandoned their Maoist roots.
Exactly.
Because of COINTELPRO. And once they saw what was happening, it was too late. It was too late. They couldn't get off the ground. And there were a lot of women, a lot of girls in the Black Panther Party after its height, with Elaine Brown. And like, it was, I think, over 70% were women. And you don't hear much about them, because, you know, it's, you know, the mainstream idea is, you know, the mainstream idea of the Black Panther Party is Bobby, Angela, and Kathleen, But you don't hear much about the women, the other women doing the work, just like the women of the Young Lords were doing the work, especially in Chicago. And once again, once they saw, even with all women leadership taking over, it was a done deal. Like Collins of Poe like destroyed the Black Panther Party, and it just couldn't get off the ground. It just couldn't get off the ground. It was like they abandoned once again the Maoist route and became zombies.
Yup. They abandoned the mass line. That's what happened. They
That's exactly.
abandoned the mass line. They abandoned survival programs. They abandoned cultural revolution. They abandoned meeting the people where they were at, and instead put their funding into campaigns to try and get Bobby Seale and Kathleen Cleaver, if I remember correctly, into office.
Right into of Oakland.
And they're and Kathleen as the mayor of Oakland and Bobby Seale as the president, if I remember correctly. And what ended up happening? They wasted their funds. They had nothing, and they just
But
couldn't get back
they just
from
couldn't
that.
get back. They just couldn't get back. It was too late. Once they saw what was going on, it was too late. They were toast. They were Swiss cheese. And that is what we have to learn from that, since it's 2023 now. We learn what went right, what went wrong, and how do we apply it to today? How can we apply it to today?
How
Because
can we? I'm sorry.
what they did, back in the late 60s and 70s, like that was the late 60s and early 80s. That was according to the material conditions at that time. This is 2023 now. We have to learn from them and apply it to where it makes sense for the conditions now.
Exactly. That's the whole point, to be fluid.
Right. And for it to change, because Assad has said if it doesn't change, it's going to fail. Look, that autobiography is the Bible.
I'm gonna read it. I'm
It's the
gonna
Re
read it.
Bible for real. Because like it's literally it's kind of essentially on par with what Mao is saying. That's essentially it's the Bible.
The fact
It's my Bible for real.
that Asada is still alive is amazing, honestly. Like that right there is just amazing. Like so many revolutionary elders end up so many re revolutionaries end up passing away, and the elders that get left behind, or rather not left behind, but the elders that end up outliving their comrades, they end up de-radicalizing and become liberals, like Angela Davis. They end up de-radicalizing and becoming liberal. So the fact that Asada is not only still alive, but she's still as radical as she was back then, that's amazing, you
Right,
know?
because she was in a different condition in
Exactly.
your homeland. So
Exactly. Honestly, yeah, no, yeah, exactly right there. Because had she stayed in America, well, not well, well, well. If she stayed in the U.S., she would be in prison. But had she stayed in the U.S., chances are that she would have either died at some point, unfortunately, or if she had survived, who knows? Maybe she would have became just like Angela Davis. Maybe she herself would have also become liberalized, you
Yeah.
know?
Yeah. And one of the people that helped her escape from the concentration camp, because that's what it is, it was Harlan Buck from Texas, who was also a political prisoner. So like that was a big deal. And the fact that she is still demonized in the U.S. media, you know, trying to call for her to come back. She's not coming back. Like, she's not coming back. She's not going to come back.
Mm-hmm.
She found her place. She knew that she had to get out. And she knew that it would not be better being in a concentration camp. And the fact that she even escaped the way she did, and it's still here, that is badassery right there.
That is, yo, I want to meet her so badly. Like, that's one of my goals, to meet Asada herself, especially, you know, especially since she currently resides in my country, in my homeland, you know, right. So that would be amazing, you know, like, especially hearing her opinions on Cuba and its materialistic conditions. But with that being said, this call, this recording has gone a bit, has gone on a bit long. So we can still talk, but I'm going to end the recording. But everyone, thank you so much for tagging along. Thank you so much for engaging this revolution. Whoever's watching this, I hope you all have a revolutionary day, and all power to the people.
All power
to the people.